Now, Joe, if you're a rocker, then you look back on LA in the 80s the way hippies look back on San Francisco in the 60s, really. It's like the golden days. We all watch Decline of Western Civilization Part 3 over and over again. I never got there in the 80s, only got there in 1990. You landed about the time Axl Rose was getting off the bus from Indiana. What was it like?
It was pretty crazy. It was lots of nights at the Rainbow, drinking with fellow band types like Motley Crue and Dio and Motorhead, and becoming friends with those guys and just really hanging out with the big hairdos, you know. And it was a lot of fun. And there was a hell of a lot of drinking going on. But it was good sort of camaraderie, you know. We there was no, like, we're better than you. We were accepted really good by the Americans, you know, from the Australian point of view. We're the Aussie boys that went over there and, you know, we're about to do big things in America. You know, the LA Times wrote after our first gig that we were going to be the next AC/DC out of Australia, which was, you know, fantastic for us.
Now, I'm sure all the, if you do interviews with the sort of mainstream press, sort of fame by association, they would love to ask you your wildest stories from touring with Judas Priest, Iron Maiden, Kiss. You've probably got a prepared answer to that one. Have you one that you can repeat, or is it none of them repeatable?
There's quite a few that are definitely not repeatable, but there's one that comes to mind that is probably able to be aired. We toured with Iron Maiden directly before we did Judas Priest, and Iron Maiden had done the same thing, toured with Judas Priest. And before we left Australia, they said, hey, listen, you want to watch those Judas Priest guys? They're nasty boys, you know. Just be really careful, tread very lightly. And we were like, oh, shit, wow, okay. So the first week of gigs, we just hung in our dressing rooms and didn't really associate with them. Until they came into our dressing room and said, hey, listen, guys, you're on the road with us for the next 3 months. Let's party. And we were like, oh, you guys are okay. We thought you were like real badasses and we couldn't talk to you. And they said, who told you that? We were like, well, all the Iron Maiden lads said you were a nasty bunch of, you know, bad, mean metalheads. And we were like, no, from that day on, it was pretty much party every night, every day. You know, we were touring in the middle of winter in America. We went on their tour bus on many occasions and, you know, stayed up all night drinking and smoking cigarettes and carrying on and just having a great time. It was just the Judas Priest boys took us in as, like, you know, really, really close friends, to even a point of when they played the US Festival in 1983, we were their very, very special guests, and they flew us down in helicopters and got us backstage. And that day, that gig, there was 380,000 people in the audience.
Yeah, it's
legendary. It was one of the most amazing, biggest gigs that I've ever been to. And it was just an absolute honour to be a guest of Judas Priest at those shows. And they laid it on for us. There were limousines there for us. There were helicopters. There was all sorts of stuff going on. Now, it was a real great day.